Hello, welcome everybody for to Talking Talent, and welcome to you too, Vanessa, for attending as a speaker today.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Yeah, for sure. Some of you might know Talking Talent already, but for the ones that don't know it yet, I want to explain the concept quickly of what Talking Talent is, and then also explain what we do at Accelerate, the company behind Talking Talent. And then we dive into the conversation with Vanessa with a small introduction and a few of the questions that are also in the description, where we end then with a Q&A from the audience, where everybody throughout the whole talk can already put in questions if they have any specific questions for Vanessa about pitch or about working remotely. Talking Talent is an event concept where we invite speakers on stage, in this sense, the virtual stage, to share their insights on topics topics on the future of work. And this time we try a bit of a different concept, because normally we start with talks and then we go into a panel and a Q&A. But now we invited actually one speaker, which is Vanessa, to really dive deep into one topic and give the audience the possibility to ask questions afterwards as well. Also introducing Accelerate, the company behind Talking Talent. So we are a recruitment startup that offers embedded recruiting services. So our talent partners become part of your team and hire great people for you. That's the idea. And we also offer services like executive recruitment and employer branding. We still hire for quite some clients in this time as well, although times are a bit tough in the industry at least. But if you need any hiring support, or if you need some consult on how to switch your hiring to remote hiring, we're happy to help as well. So you can contact me afterwards, or go to our website, accelerate.com as well. This is our team at Accelerate, and also behind Talking Talent. These are the different services I described. And then I want to kick off our talk and ask Vanessa to give a quick introduction about yourself and yourself as founder of Pitch, but also yourself from like owning a people function in Pitch, because we'll go deeper into that in our talk later.
As you said, my name is Vanessa. I'm a co-founder of Pitch. We are 8 co-founders, and I'm basically owning the people function, or everything that's basically not product related. And we started Pitch 2 years ago, and we are now 70 people. Grew quite quickly. My background was always people and HR. I always cared about building like a progressive organization, changing the way how people are working. I started my career in advertising, worked in London for a few years, and ever since then, I knew I don't want to support a work environment in which people burn out and things are not human-centered and fair and all that. And I studied business psychology at some point and went down into that path, and then ended up in HR and now building my own company, which has been super exciting. And that's about me.
Okay, great. And I also heard that Pitch has 8 founders. And how do you decide which founder focus on which part, and then you yourself on the people function?
So all of us work together at Wunderlist. So we all have been working together. We know how everyone is working and what their expertise is. So it was pretty clear from the beginning who's owning what. So we have 4 technical co-founders who are obviously working on the code base and the product. We have 1 design co-founder thinking about the brand, and 1 more doing more the admin side of things, and obviously our CEO. So I think things have been pretty clear for all of us in the beginning, and I think that's also been helpful for us than starting the company with 8 co-founders, because it's been super clear who's where each other's strengths are living and what we want to focus on as an individual in the company. So that was great.
I can imagine, and also in these times of COVID-19, it's actually nice to have a strong founder team that can bring a different perspective on coming up with solutions as well.
I think this has given us the chance to really like start things quickly, because we had like 8 perspectives on the table from the very beginning, and it helps you to like decentralized decision making and really have people owning things and not having just maybe one or two key people making the decision in like typical startups. And so we've been pretty fast in making things happen pretty quick. So it's been a good situation, I guess.
Yeah. Tell me, so what were like the biggest learnings that you got out of this last month where you had to switch from like partly remote company to fully remote company now?
I think biggest learnings, it's been a difficult situation for humankind, I would say, for everyone as an individual in their personal life. And I think the most important thing as a company or as a founder is to empathize with everyone and really acknowledge that things drastically change for everyone and to really be transparent about, for example, that we expect a productivity drop and really help people in their situations. People have their children at home or other people struggle with depression, who knows. It's just important to be transparent and communicate things clear. And I think that's been working out well. And I think that's been very important for us to really talk to the people and proactively check in with everyone. Another learning is also obviously to, as I said, be clear with expectations to everyone and create a framework for everyone what's expected and as I said, be also human and empathizing with everyone and then over communicate and avoid that we end up in silos and things get lost and create basically a healthy routine for the team over Slack in which we communicate regularly, say hi in the morning or share food pictures or whatever to really help everyone to stay connected and socialize with each other.
When you say like a framework of expectations, could you visualize that a bit more, or like have an example on how you as pitched and make that shift to also put your expectations from the team more in a framework, and how would companies go about that are looking for the same solution?
It really depends on the structure of your company and also what you're building. For us, we obviously have regular check-ins with our product teams in which we review the roadmap and speak about, can we still deliver this and that? Do we have to make adjustments? Do we have to reprioritize things? As a whole company, really sink in on the progress on things and really reevaluate. For example, we are planning our launch this year, and which is super exciting, and we are still confident that we're going to do it, and it's not going to change the timeline. But obviously, then you have to review your roadmap. Are all the things we want to do still feasible? And basically, as I said, have reviews with your team on their projects and the product they are building, and supportive and understanding if things don't go as we planned, you know, and stay flexible about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's the power of having a startup as well, right? So a startup can actually adapt and be quite flexible in changing in these times as well.
Yeah, exactly.
And then what is for you personally then the biggest switch to this fully remote setup suddenly?
Pardon, can you repeat your question?
For you personally, what was for you the biggest change in switching to a fully remote setup?
For me personally or for the company?
Yeah, for you personally.
For me, I think my job is being like talking to everyone and being connected. And now I have like 5 million Slack messages and back-to-back Slack calls, every day, Zoom calls. And I think my challenge is to really focus my focus and not get lost in all the over-communication and really filter the information and really structure my day and structure myself, and also don't forget to not get burned out. Because when we all work from home, you get zoomed into your work and forget it's 8 p.m. and you kind of worked the whole day and didn't get out. So I think to really prevent yourself and getting lost in your work and give yourself some spare time to reflect and also to go outside, have a walk and things like that. I think that's, I think, has been my personal challenge for sure.
Yeah, and what is your tip there? For I assume a lot of people are struggling with the same, right? This work blending into their private life, because yeah, your work is literally in your bedroom or in your private life. How do you make sure to put the relaxation time in?
I mean, I think what has been helping me is to create my personal routine, like to really sit down. Okay, so I'm gonna have breakfast, I'm gonna have my coffee here, and then I'm gonna start working, and then like I'm gonna work 3 hours and then do my lunch, and really set time in for that, and really time yourself, time box your work, and also when you schedule your meetings and your conversations with others, that you stay mindful that you can't do like 6 back-to-back Zoom calls, you know, and just really manage your own time and your routine around that. That's been helpful.
Nice. Yeah, cool. And then also diving a bit more in your role on leading the people function, I want to go over a few different topics that we already discussed beforehand as well. But how Pitch is dealing with that when they first of all were a partly remote company and now currently a fully remote company. So yep. I think the hiring topic really suits Talking Talent well, but how do you hire and onboard remotely in Pitch? What are your best practices to share with the listeners?
I mean, so for us, not much change, because mm-hmm. like for us, we had always 1/3 of the team remote. That means we always had at least 1 or 2 people in each team being remote. So the hiring process already had to cater for that. So we had to always obviously make sure to keep our remotees equal and not have these office conversations. So, but I mean, how we hire remote hasn't really changed. We always like involve the whole team in our searches. We are spreading the news of new searches and on Slack. Every step of the interview process is via Zoom. It's always has been. I mean, we usually always invited people over at some point for a meeting, but now this is happening via Slack. Also the challenge delivery, which is usually a workshop that you do, is happening by Zoom, and I think it hasn't been a big change for us in that sense, and it's been working well. The way how we collect feedback about hires is via Slack or Greenhouse. We always have like dedicated Slack channels for hires, so it's kind of happening the same as before. I think the only thing that changed has been the onboarding process a little bit, because normally we would fly people into Berlin and get them to meet everyone and have some social time. And now you have to really make sure to create a process in which people really still have face-to-face time to some degree and really know who actually joined. Since January, we have like 4 to 5 people joining every month. And it's been obviously important that everyone kind of knows who is this new person, where does this person know, and they're all also over-communicating has been important. So we have, for example, our team bulletins in which people report the progress of their team every week. And also the people team always introduces new hires there that are joining with a little story about them. Then we have, for example, when the people join, always via Slack, like this welcome channel where we welcome new people and they say hi, everyone says hi and introduces them a little bit. And then the face-to-face part we are now doing basically always on Fridays, where we have a little meet and greet where like the whole company gets together via Zoom, and then the new starter can introduce them personally to everyone, and that's been working out pretty nice. So everyone has actually a face, not just a photo. That's been working well. And then connecting the new hires with our department leads to make sure they know what's going on outside of their domain has also been important. But we've been doing this also before. Did I answer your question? Or
definitely. I think this translation of social events into remote events is what every company is currently being super creative with, and I think it's actually an opportunity to improve a lot of that communication flow instead of like seeing it as a blockade basically.
Yeah, and I mean, one thing I can recommend, what we are also doing is we have the, it's called Donut, this app, and it's like connecting people on a weekly basis for a random coffee. So basically you, people just connect with each other randomly and have a meeting, a lunch, or like a coffee, whatever they feel like. And I think that's been nice to really connect people outside of their team and getting to know other people and checking in with like various parts of the team. So I can recommend that actually.
Yeah, nice. We also use that, and it's basically copying this interaction on that you run into somebody in the office and talk with somebody, right? And now it's sort of connected online.
Yeah.
Yeah, super cool tip as well. Yeah, and that also feeds into, or a few of your examples already feed into, how do you actually build that culture with your team partly remote as you had it beforehand, but now fully remote as of the situation, right? So how do you build and maintain that culture?
I mean, I must say we are still learning it and figuring things out. I think we obviously don't, I would say it's all, we know everything, but I think there are lots of things you can try and play around with. And I think for us, the biggest challenge has always been to really equalize our remotees with our office team, because like naturally people might have these like kitchen chats and make a decision, and then the person who's not sitting in Berlin feels excluded. And these are the things you really have to make sure to avoid. That's why it's important to really make sure if you make decisions to make them with every stakeholder, every key stakeholder, make them via Zoom and not like with a casual conversation. Make sure. We also have this rule, actually, also since we are in the office where we have all hands meetings, everyone, even though you are in the office, has to dial in via Zoom to their computer to all hands, just so everyone is equal, because there might be like an own dynamic happening when you have like, I don't know, 10 people in a room and three people being remote. It's usually then that it's easier to exclude them from the conversation a little bit. So taking and consideration these things, and then usually when we onboard people, we always fly them in for at least a week. They have personal face-to-face time with everyone, because then it's also easier to really empathize with each other via Slack when you had this personal situation with each other. And I think in general, keeping both worlds equally engaged and equally making sure no one feels excluded it's a difficult thing, and I hope we are doing a good job. But I think with little rituals where you kind of considerately make sure that everyone communicates clearly to the team, no matter if you are sitting in Berlin or not, and make sure that decisions are tracked and followed through on Notion, for example. We Notion is our knowledge base and where we store all the projects, and you can really follow through with decisions that are made, and usually the outcome is then communicated through Slack. The challenge is to keep things updated, obviously. So you really have to train yourself with this, and then also really make sure that you train everyone how to use each communication channel is also important, because when people start new, they don't know, so where do I place this information? Who do I inform with that? And really have a little dicky that helps you to define those rules and these little etiquette around how to communicate things are important.
Yes. Yeah, and what you're saying as well, that it's so important to make this distinction between like everything is remote or everything is not remote, right? So if you actually then have make decisions in conversations or like communicate conversations, and you don't document it online, then a part of the company won't even know about it, right?
Yeah.
So you need to full in or nothing. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's why it's important. I think when you start a company, or if you start it now, to really practice asynchronous communication for the whole team. So basically that everyone, no matter when they check into work, are able to follow through what happened. And that's why, for example, our team bulletins are great, because everyone can read the progress of the company when and making sure that it's really updated and tracked. I think this is key, because only then you can really make sure everyone is able to do their best work when they really know which decision has been made, why, and everyone is equally involved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. Cool. And then also this already, we touched upon a few of the, or a few parts of this topic already, but how do you keep communication flowing between sort of the onsite and remote team? And then you already mentioned a few things, but what came actually from an attendee before the webinar is also, how do you communicate in throughout these different time zones that the team is located in?
I mean, that's also partially, I think, what I covered right now with this asynchronous communication, that you make sure that you are getting out of this routine. Everything has to happen in a meeting. You have to really get into a routine where people, for example, practice stand-ups together. So basically you have a Slack channel and you just update each other what you're doing today or what you worked on, but then you can see it in a different time, obviously, and not force everything to happen in a meeting. And then also start learning to get into a routine to really question yourself, do I need a meeting for this, or can it just be like a Slack update, or can it just be a little message in Notion, to not waste everyone's time. Just be mindful with these things, right? And I think, yeah, thinking about rethinking your reporting progress and your decision-making progress process is probably the most important thing to make sure that you create a culture that facilitates remote work and an equal culture for everyone. What we also did is also we started to introduce the Discord app, actually, where people can hang out at every time and work together. So this is the gaming app, and you can basically just hang out and work on the side and just feel like you can talk to someone. I think that's been nice because people do this randomly and still kind of talk about things and sometimes, yeah, work together. I think that was also helpful. I had so many ideas what else I wanted to mention. As I said, creating clear remote rules, how you communicate is important. Mm-hmm. Create like a guide, how you do communication, what are the rules, and how do you manage meetings, and do you want to set up a meeting or no? Do you want to update your team? I think that's the most helpful thing to do, or most important thing to do.
I think that is important in a non-remote company as well, right? And now that we're remote, it's a bit more sort of in the spotlight that everything needs to be detailed and like documented really thoroughly in order to let the communication flow in the right way.
Yeah, and also just knowing where to place this information so people really can digest it and not just read it and forget it. And just have clear rules how you use your channels and how you define basically how you define the etiquette around communication. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you have used Notion, but this has been also super helpful for us in really documenting progress and stuff.
Yeah, great. Cool. And then, also moving on from that as well, how do you sort of keep your team motivated and united while you work remote? Because what we also ourselves sometimes see is that we host a lot of fun events, but then the motivation in the beginning of the remote setup was really high, but then the motivation also goes down. So how do you keep your team sort of pumped like you would do maybe in the office with, I don't know, an energizer or like, small speech that you give, but now you need to do it remote?
I think, as I said, you can like support socializing via also dedicated Slack channels. Like, for example, we have an appreciation channel where people get a taco for, oh, thanks for doing this, or thanks for doing that, or tacos to this team for being amazing. We use that. And we have like a memes channel where people, for example, share memes and just laugh with each other and share like topics they care about, or cats and dogs channel, or hiking. And we have like so many channels that are more catered around fun and where people, depending on what they care about, can connect with each other. We also started this routine around our food channel where people post what they eat today. So they are like, oh, look, I've been cooking this. And then the other person says, great, or I'm inspired. And so you can, yeah, support some socializing through that. And then, as I said, the Discord app has been helpful for some people in our team where they can just like hang out and just talk to each other without being in work mode, but just like speak while they are working. So they feel a little bit like an office environment. That's been also great. And yeah, other than that, I think these all hands that we have sometimes are also helpful. We had like last week this one meeting that was like really just, yeah, everyone could join, but it wasn't required, but it was basically just a hangout where everyone was chatting and speaking about what's moving them or what's in their head and how they feel. And it was after work, and I think it was also nice because people really, I think they just spoke 10% about work and the rest was just about personal things. And I think that was important for everyone to also connect, reconnect on other things and not just about work. Yeah.
And how do you make the communication in sort of this remote setup inclusive as well? Because you have people that are happy to speak up in front of a camera, right? Or that speak a bit more up in meetings. And I think a lot of people that are either more shy or maybe even more introverted are saying less in those meetings. How do you make sure that everybody feels like they can share their thoughts and ideas equally?
I think it's a challenge for individuals that are probably introverted who don't want to share thoughts in an open channel and stuff. But I think, yeah, it's important that you as a company build trust amongst your team and really support trust within every relationship you have at work and ask people for their opinion proactively, ask them how they are. And some people don't share things by themselves or don't give feedback by themselves, but ask them how they feel about something or how do you think we handled this or how do you think the new design looks like. I think you need to proactively involve more people, especially the quiet ones that are not sharing things by themselves. And I think it's also part of the people team's work and founders work to really check in with people proactively if they are doing okay and how they are feeling with the new situation. And I think it's about that, proactively checking in with everyone.
Yeah, and as maybe also even in those meetings, assigning people to talk, right, or calling them out on speaking up, and like you would do it actually in a non-remote meeting as well.
Yeah, exactly. How you would do this in a coffee chat or like when you go to the kitchen or,
Sure. And then also a question actually that came also from an attendee of this webinar, which I think thought was really interesting. So how would you use pitch as a product also, or how is his pitch useful in this remote setup for companies as well, more and more? Because communication should be a bit more visual if it's done remotely, right? Would love to hear your thoughts on how to use your product in this situation.
So first of all, I mean, we have a lot of great collaboration features that are meant to support collaboration and also collaboration not in the same place, not at the same time. So I think with the help of like these communication, the way how you can chat in the presentation and tag someone and really monitor the progress of a slide, I mean, this like is meant to work for remote teams and for people who are not sitting in the same office and working on the same file. Mm-hmm. So that's working well. And then obviously we defined some new use cases for how you can use, for example, presentations like to report, right? And the way how we do it is, as you know, I think you saw the post we put out last week about our team bulletins, where basically every team on Friday afternoon, whenever they have the time, fill in their updates and then we share it with everyone. And it's like 60 people working on the same presentation at the same time on different places and working well. Everyone is enjoying it and loving it. And also then it's just fun to scroll through this and seeing which team worked on what. And I'm looking forward that the world can see it soon.
Yeah, I think so as well. I was lucky enough to try out the beta version, but I'm sure there's some more people in this webinar that also want to have the early access to.
Yeah, it will happen soon.
Cool. Yeah, cool. I want to actually switch to the audience Q&A. During the moment that we're talking, already some great questions came in as well. So maybe one that also follows up on how pitch can be helpful, because these reports you can also put into a presentation, right? So this question came from Anna, and she said, how do you make sure that keeping the management updated, so reports and updates from employees and Zoom calls, etc., does not turn into micromanagement when you're in a remote setup?
Good question. I mean, in general, I think our leadership team is pretty really letting people work on their own roadmaps. The teams have their own defined goals and people just report on them, but not to the leadership team, more to the team, because the team wants to know, hey, how is that feature going? How is that going? It's everyone's interest, and it's not just the leadership team that's interested in how the progress of things is. And it's more about really making sure that we are all aligned as a company on what's happening. And it's really for no one in the leadership team about really like micromanaging, because I think everyone is really, I think people are really, or the teams are set up that they can actually work on their own and asynchronous without the leadership being there, you know? It's really more about the mindset that we have in the team, that everyone wants to know it. And it's more really about, I'm proud of what I did and I want to share it with the team. So I think it's more about the communication around what you expect from that. And I think reporting always has this feeling of, oh, I have to tell my boss what I did. But it's more about, hey, I'm actually proud. This week was great and I did this and that. And showing it with photos or showing it with like GIFs and animations. And I think it's just really spreading the excitement about the product amongst the team, what we do with that. I don't know if I answered your question now, actually.
I would say so. It is Anna's question. But I think it is sort of two-way communication instead of only reporting one way, right? I think that's what you're summing up a bit with these examples as well. And that makes it less micromanagement and just informing each other on the great work that you're actually doing.
Exactly.
Cool. And next question as well, which is super relevant to also your role as VP of People, and that is coming from Maresh. And this person is asking, what challenges are newly remote managers facing, and how do you support them as from out your people function?
So I think what we did in the beginning, before we started being partially remote, we hired some key people that have been super senior in remote work. Mm-hmm. Taught us a lot, of things we wouldn't know as someone who has never worked remote. And I would give that as a key thing for everyone who starts looking into hiring remote people. Look for people who have been doing this for a long time, because they will tell you what to consider. And also we have a lot of remote managers, so people who have not been in Berlin for the most time and always been remote. So they basically, we created like a network internally, like a peer-to-peer coaching situation where people just exchange experiences and thoughts amongst the management team and the middle management team. And I think, being really like transparent around the struggles and really looking for like solutions amongst the team has been very helpful. Yeah. So I think as a people team, we basically created like a channel for them to exchange each other's thoughts and really help looking into like a team solution for that, because the team leads, from my perspective, from my perspective, also a team, and they have to help each other with their struggles as managers. And to our goal is to basically facilitate this conversation and help to with guidelines, helping them to, yeah, define the solutions and helping the new managers to get onboarded with these insights.
Yeah, that makes sense. Clear. Cool. And then the next question is coming from Richard, and he's saying, how will this affect your decision in the future when it comes to renting a new office? Would your tendency to go more towards co-working or flex office solutions? So I think, yeah, he's referring to the situation of everybody being fully remote and like, what is then the purpose of an office still?
Yeah, I mean, I think we thought about it, but for us, it's not an option to give up the office. We know we want to go back because people really love having the office space and being there, maybe not, again, 5 days a week, but we want to give them the chance to get together there. I think having a flex office solution and co-working space, I think I'm not a fan of that right now, because we really have our office. We want to brand it. We want to have it as our space and as our headquarter, and really want to feel like that, and don't want to like also scale down the team and then have like a smaller office space or a bigger office space. We think more long term and really want to find a place and settle down. And we did. And so we kind of stay there. And co-working spaces have not been an option for us in that regard. But I think for companies that don't grow that steadily and just like sustain to be like a small team and they don't know, I think for that it totally makes sense to look into these things. But for us, we were already too big and really wanted to look more into like a long-term head office.
And you're saying not 5 days a week, so are you also offering partly remote work to your employees already?
Or? I mean, that's always been the case. Like, we have people fully remote, we have some people partially remote, and we have some people just coming to the office every day, and we have some people just coming to the office once in a while, and we don't we don't force anyone to come to work, to come to the office.
Do you have an open policy there? Like, what is written in Notion on it?
I mean, there's nothing written on it. It's basically people can work from wherever they want as long as they do their job great. It's fine. It doesn't have to be sitting on the desk in the office. As long as everyone is contributing, it's, I think, really up to them how and when they work, right? At least for us.
Yeah, that makes sense. And another question from Johan was coming in, and he asked, how many Zoom meetings do you handle a day? I think three is too much already. So how many Zoom meetings do you do every day?
I think my favorite would be also three or two, but my reality is six right now. Sometimes they are shorter, sometimes they are longer. I'm sometimes very happy when they get canceled.
You have some focus time, yeah.
No, today I was looking very much forward to it, also to every other call. But I think it depends also on the level of, like, what type of Zoom call it is. If it's just a check-in with my team, great, I'm looking forward. If it's like a mentally draining, really intense conversation around, I don't know, product decisions or whatever, then it's obviously you can only handle two or three of these. Depends on the level of intensity, I would say. But I think three is a good number to aim for everyone.
Yeah, and do you have a way of making them really effective as well?
I mean, I think it's also kind of a really like a thing you have to be aware of, but it depends on the meeting. But ideally, every meeting has an agenda. Ideally, every meeting has an owner. Ideally, every meeting gets like, how do you say, you take notes, and ideally every time there's an outcome defined and everyone knows what they have to work on and what the goal is of the next meeting. I think this is should be like a meeting etiquette. I don't know if it happens all the time like this though. I think sometimes also to really, I sometimes ask the meeting owner back what type of meeting is it? Is it a decision-making meeting? Is it more brainstorming, or is it, what is it? And why do we get together? And why does it have to be in this frame? And why can't we maybe just do this in another way? So I think really starting with everyone asking themselves when they set up a meeting, do you really need that? And do you really need all these people in there, is very important.
Yeah, setting the right purpose before a meeting, I think, is it makes it more effective.
Yeah.
Cool. And then Spiros was asking how pitch is affected by Corona. Do you still hire people at this moment, or do you consider a pause or a short time work?
We hire like crazy. But we hire a lot of people. We had like a quite good ambitious hiring plan for this year, and we are still continuing everything as planned. We were lucky enough that we raised great funding last year and are now safe for like a couple of years. That's why our whole plan has luckily not been really affected. Also, we are not launched yet. We are not dependent on sales as of right now. We have nothing that's really changing or should change what we are doing right now. I think there might be a delay in how we launch, or might be a delay in the way how sales might kick off. But in any case, we are safe with our financials for some time. So we can really be sure that our team is having their salary covered for the future, and we can still scale the team, which is fortunate. And we are still building the product and we are still gonna launch. So I think for us, we were lucky enough that we haven't been affected yet. I mean, we don't know if things drastically change in a year, and we are still, I don't know, the economy crashes, no one has any budget to consider working with a new presentation tool, might all be possible, but we want to look more positive into this, and that's why we continue our plans as of now. We have backup plans, but we don't expect them that we need them.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think when you have this funding already secured, you at least have a runway for the coming years, exactly. Right? Okay, cool. And then actually the last question from Angela is something that we covered already a bit, but she's specifically asking, how do you keep the team motivated to attend outside work team events, coffee and lunches? Because it feels quite challenging with the new remote situation. And I think it's really, it means that how do you get people to come to those meetings over and over again?
We don't have outside work events right now, actually. Because we followed the rules that we are not allowed to go outside.
No, but I think outside the working hours is what she means here. How do you make sure people attend like the informal meetups that are not?
To be honest, I think we really give everyone their space for their private life. I think we don't say, hey, you should do this or that. I think we are just transparent that people should manage their own workload. And really don't get caught up by too much work, and really stay healthy and take care of themselves. I think some of us share tips what you can do in quarantine, and read this book, or like what do you have ideas for? I don't know, painting and stuff like that. And I think it's important to really facilitate these type of conversation, offsite conversations from people that are more related to these things. So people really share ideas and think about other things than work. I think in terms of like coffee or lunches, I think, as I said, we have more this food channel where people really post like food they have eaten or food they want to cook or hikes they did and sharing photos. That's what we do, and I think that's the least invasive thing you can do to help people stay how they maybe keep healthy in their life.
That makes sense. Cool. And then actually one more question that was not upvoted is also which tools do you use for remote work? You mentioned Slack and Donut and Zoom and Notion so far. Um, Do you have any other recommendations that on apps or tools that you use on a daily basis to make your work easier?
As we all need it, the calendar, Google Calendar, that's our life right now, I guess.
Yeah.
That one. As I said, the Discord app has been a thing for us, and Pitch. That has been our thing, and I think other than that, GitHub obviously for our engineers. Some of us actually started using Threads, which is an app to really communicate on decisions made in little teams. You should look this up. I don't know where I could post this here, but it's I can send you the link later. We are playing around with this one, which is supposed to make decision making even more transparent and easier to follow up. GitHub, obviously, Pitch.
Nice. Cool. Yeah, we will definitely be sharing all the content on this talk and the answers that you gave to all the questions, but also list the tools afterwards. So let's sync on any tools that you want to share with me, and then I will put it in the package afterwards as well.
Yeah.
Cool. I think that answered all the questions of the audience as well. And we're nicely in time as well. So thank you so much, Vanessa, for spending your time with us today and giving us a bit of insight on how Pitch works and also how you build actually a successful remote company.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for the nice chat. And I'm looking forward to meeting everyone who attended one day somewhere in Berlin. And hope you had a good time. And
we're definitely going to repeat like a Talking Talent also in person once we can do those events again. And then we would love to host you again.
Yeah, sounds great. Nice meeting you all.
Yeah, thank you. Cool. And then, for all the attendees, thank you so much for coming today and sending great questions to Vanessa. I think we all got a bit wiser on how to build a company out remotely. And feel free to reach out in case of any follow-up questions as well. And we're going to host a few more webinars, actually, on Talking Talent. So tomorrow we have one on how to find a job in this challenging times as well, and how to find companies like Pitch that are still hiring. And next week, we actually are hosting an event on how to switch your hiring from onsite to remote. So also really relevant in this time. But thank you all. And hope to see you again.
Nice.